perspective on leadership, and I believe if the perspective that Jesus provided was applied to the civil society and the church, we would have a better world. Because Jesus here outlines in Matthew 20, and let us look at it again, Matthew 20, and beginning at verse 25, Jesus, the great teacher, the keenest intellect that ever lived, said, "But Jesus called them unto him and said, Ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you, but whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And I say amen.
Amen.
Before I venture any further into God's word, I will invite the greatest teacher to guide the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Our righteous eternal Father, we thank you so much for all your gifts. And we thank you for one of the greatest gifts you have ever given mankind outside of Jesus himself. And that is the Holy Spirit. And as you have promised, Lord, you have promised that he will guide us into all truth. And this morning I ask that you will send him to guide us into all truth. He's a member of the Godhead, and he's the best comforter that we could ever have our need. And Lord, we just ask that he will be the teacher this morning, because I don't know how to rightly share your word with your people.
Yeah.
But the Holy Spirit knows every heart, and I'm depending on him to teach this morning. So I'm asking you, Lord, please bless us to this end. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Christ said that the Gentiles, and Gentiles are persons who are without God, they exercise dominion and authority over persons. But God said to his church, he was speaking to his 12 disciples, Jesus said, "It shall not be so among you." And in another synoptic gospel, he said that all of us are actually brethren. So there is no place really for us to exercise dominion over each other. Let's look at Genesis 1:26 to see that Jesus didn't come up with some strange new concept. Genesis 1 and verse 26. Because remember when Jesus was approached by the Sadducees about a woman being married to a man, and then she died, and the man died and she got married to another brother, and then that brother died and she got married to another brother, and they were trying to ensnare him to say that the resurrection wasn't correct. And Jesus said that they do err not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. And he had to outline that in the beginning it was not so. Divorce and so on was not so from in the beginning. God permits certain things, but in the beginning, and what he's saying is that in the beginning is how things were perfectly supposed to operate. And in Genesis 1 verse 26, God outlines that in the beginning, this is how he really outlined dominion for human beings. It says, "And God said, Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the people all around them." Did the Bible say that? Let them have dominion over what? The fish of the sea, and over what? The fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Are we fish and cattle?
No.
Are we bugs and reptiles?
No.
Are we 40 legs and snakes?
No.
Are we scorpions?
No.
So in right, do any of us have the right to exercise dominion over the other?
No.
No. Human beings were never intended to have dominion over human beings. Originally, God wanted man only to have dominion over lower forms of life. Because God knows that when man starts to exercise dominion over man, something is going to go wrong. You know, Israel had the greatest king. Israel had God for their king. And Israel is no different from Israel was back then. Israel had the greatest king. Israel had God for their king. Their king would provide food miraculously without a supermarket. Their king would provide free power. You know, they had a light system that would come on at night. It was a pillar of fire by night. And by day, God ensured that the heat of the desert would not burn them. But did Israel rejoice in that king? No, they said that give us a king like the nations around us. Give us a king that would trample us under his foot. Give us a king that would help heavily tax us. Give us a king that will give us a hard time and turn our daughters into house laborers and turn our sons into soldiers. They didn't want that. And do you know, brothers and sisters, that we are now much different from Israel of old? You know that we don't delight in God's leadership. You know some of us look to political parties for leadership. There's a place for civil government, and I am glad that God allowed civil government to have laws and regulations to keep us in check. But our confidence should never be in civil government. Amen. Because whether or not you want to accept it, brothers and sisters, civil government is not God's idea. You know, brothers and sisters, on both ends of the spectrum, there is a lot of self-serving that takes place. Amen. Both sides of the spectrum. I thank God I've been around to see both parties, both top parties, I should say, run the government. And I've heard complaints when the government is orange, and I've heard complaints when the government is green. And brothers and sisters, all that shows is that the only person's leadership that we can put confidence in is the leadership of God Himself.
Amen.
Because brothers and sisters, man will disappoint. The Bible says, cease ye from man whose breath is in his nostrils. Do you know that even the best of kings from the Bible itself fail? And we're going to see that even the best of kings in the Bible fail. Now, Israel wanted a king like every other nation all around them. And brothers and sisters, we can look at 1 Kings and see the example of a king called Saul. Saul, do you know that Saul was actually a good king at one point in time?
Yes.
Saul was a very good king, and Saul actually received what we call the spirit of prophecy. He actually was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied among the prophets. And there was a proverb that came as a result of it, and they asked the question, is Saul also numbered among God's prophets? He had this wonderful personality. Saul was a humble person. When God actually sent to anoint Saul, Saul was actually hiding behind a cart. He didn't want to be king. Never wanted to rule over such a powerful nation. But do you know that the record that Saul had back then actually changed over time? Started out good, but did not remain good. And in 1 Kings 8, here's why God outlined that you couldn't put confidence in men. In 1 Kings 8 and verse 9, it says, now therefore hearken to their voice. God here is talking to Samuel, because when Israel asked for a king, Samuel was so disappointed. Samuel was saying, you have the greatest thing and you're asking for a human being. And he was upset. He was cut up over it, because Samuel knew God. He had a personal relationship with God, and he knew that God was exceedingly good. And Israel didn't see that, and Samuel said something very important, that Samuel shouldn't feel very bad. Because in rejecting the counsel of Samuel, they did not reject Samuel, they rejected God Himself. And brothers and sisters, do you know that when you reject the counsels of prophets, you are rejecting God and not the prophet? And I'm saying that for a specific reason. Because one of the identifying gifts of God's remnant church is the gift of prophecy. And brothers and sisters, when you want to know how to lead aright, go into those volumes. Because those volumes contain information that would actually cause us to prosper as a people. And one of the reasons why we are not prospering is that we have leaders who don't pay attention to God's prophetic voice. Amen. Brothers and sisters, if we were listening to the voice of the prophet, some of the problems that we have in our churches wouldn't exist. If we were listening to the voice of the prophet, some of the health problems that we have would not exist. Amen. And if we were listening to the prophet, many of the problems we have in our homes would not exist. You know, brothers and sisters, oftentimes our youth get a hard time. The world over in churches, the youth get a hard time. Persons who say to the youth, oh, they are going into places that they ought not to go. They are doing things that they ought not to do. And we would pray for the youth and say, oh Lord, these youth are not going to be saved if they don't change. But brothers and sisters, do you know that the majority of the time, the reasons that the youth stray, the main reason why the youth stray, is because they don't have sound examples. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, we like to claim promises when our young children are giving problems. I would like to quote and challenge God. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's older, he shall not depart from it. And we like to hold God to his promises, but we, many times, don't keep our end of the bargain. You know, one prophet said that the best thing you can do for your children is to teach them to reason from cause to effect. You know, many of the times, we don't teach our children the cause and effect of why we do what we do and why we don't do what we do. You just tell your child, don't drink Coca-Cola. Are you tell the child, don't wear jewelry? Are you tell the child, don't wear this? Are you tell the child, don't do that? Or say that, but we don't teach them how to reason from cause to effect. A prophet said, when they learn to reason from cause to effect, they will avoid many problems that they find themselves in. And oftentimes, the reality of the issue is that we don't even know why we are Seventh-day Adventists. So we can't even transmit to the youth why they ought to be upstanding Seventh-day Adventists. And I say amen.
Amen.
So sometimes we are beating the poor youth down into the ground, but oftentimes we did not do our job properly. Amen. And brothers and sisters, we should stop treating the young people as though they are the future of the church. They are the present of the church.
Amen.
God said, young man, I call upon you for you are strong. God wants them now.
Yes.
Because one prophet said that with such an army of youth rightly trained,
yes,
would service, how soon will the earth hear of its soon coming Redeemer? Mm-hmm. With such an army of youth rightly trained. He never said with such an army of youth. Because this church already has an army of youth, but the youth have to be rightly trained.
Yeah.
It says, as such an army of youth rightly trained would furnish, how soon would our entire world hear of it soon coming Redeemer? So the reason why the church is in peril and the world is in peril is not because we don't have enough young people in church. It's because they are not yet rightly trained. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I've been invited to youth days all over this island, and I found that the young people are the foremost to respond to God's undiluted message.
Amen.
You know that young people know what they ought to do and what they ought not to do? But brothers and sisters, sometimes it's like they don't see the power of God unto salvation inside the church, in us. A lot of the times they are looking for the power, but they are not seeing it in us. So what we ought to do is tap into the power for ourselves, and then we can really assist the young people. Because sometimes they know that we are not to be eating and drinking certain things, but they see us undermining the faith. As adults, they see us doing it. And when they see it, they are saying, why should I force the issue and try to be different when this person is undermining what they say they stand up to? And then they are finding compromise out in the school system. And then they come to church and they want to find firm pillars, but they can't find it. You know? Brothers and sisters, it's always easy to kill us blame. But one thing that I've come to personalize in my own heart is that I must strive to be the change that I want to see in life. Because it would make me a hypocrite to have this high standard for somebody else, and I'm not struggling to get to that standard myself. So let us not beat the young people into the ground. Let us ensure that we are at the standard. And even when you are at the standard, it doesn't mean you should go arrogantly to the young people and say, be like me. Because if by the grace of God you get to the standard, it was only by the grace of God you got there. The Bible says our hearts are deceitful and wicked above all things.
Yes.
And who can know it? So naturally, there is nothing good in us. If there is good being manifested in our lives, it's because of the virtue of Christ and his righteousness.
Amen.
Now therefore hearken unto their voice, obey, yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. And Samuel told all the words unto the people that asked of him a king, and he said, this will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots to be his horsemen, and shall run before his chariots. And he will appoint him captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his throne, and to reap his harvest, and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. And he will take your daughters to be confectionaries, and to be cooks, and to be bakers. And he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. And he will take the tenth of your seed and of your vineyards and give to his officers and to his servants, And he will take your men servants and your maid servants, your goodliest young men and your asses, and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants. And ye shall cry out in that day because of your king, which ye shall have chosen you. And the Lord will not hear you in that day. You know, we like to quote the Bible and say, oh, God believes in this kind of government because God appointed them. Yeah, God did it. God in his permissive way. And I said permissive and not perfect way. Because God's perfect will is that he should be our king. Yes. But in his permissive way, he said you can have kings over yourself. But God said there will be a consequence. And where the consequence is listed good. God said that they would have a young men like Papi Shoes. They would have them doing all manner of things and your daughters as Papi Shoes as well. That is what God was really outlining to Israel. That your society will be abused by these people. Yes. And Saul, who started out humble, by the time he got round to David, Saul never wanted to obey God strictly. There was a day when God said that he wanted a sacrifice, and it was only the prophet or the priest Samuel that could offer that sacrifice. And Samuel tarried. And just because he did not see Samuel coming, he started to use his own mind and started to conjure up an idea that, you know, God's word is not so strict. After all, I am the king. And even though God said, I can only accept sacrifice from priests, I will go and bypass what God said, and I will have a sacrifice, because God is taking too long. So we have to do things in our way. Let's do it a new way, because God is taking too long. And brothers and sisters, do you know that we find ourselves doing that as God's people? Yes. Sometimes God gives specific instructions, and we are saying, oh, the Lord is taking too long to come back. And it's modern times. So we have to change things up a bit while we wait. Brothers and sisters, you can never be more modern than God. You can never be more modern than God. Because God is everlasting. And God is in the future while he's in the present and the past simultaneously. So you can never be more current or more modern than God. And if God's word says something, then it is very much modern. Because it is the spoken thoughts of God. And God's thoughts are far ahead of our thoughts. Not only higher, it's far ahead of our thoughts. God is on the cutting edge of technology. God is on the cutting edge of change. And you are talking about old time religion. This religion is a modern religion because God exists in the future. Our God is the God of tomorrow, today, and yesterday. But sometimes God doesn't act in the timeline that we want. So we say, oh, we have to do according to our own thoughts and our own will. That is not correct leadership. And that is not the character that God wants us to form, brothers and sisters. So Saul disobeyed God's explicit, straight instructions, and he offered sacrifice. And the kingdom was taken from him. And do you know that over time, this humble king, when he saw that God never approved of his ways anymore, he started to feel discontented himself, and he didn't really repent of what he did. Even then, God gave him a second chance and said, you know, the enemies of God are out there, and I want you to get rid of this king Agag. I want you to go and get rid of this entire vicinity. I want you to get even rid of the animals in the vicinity. And Saul went and he said that he's going to do what God said. But he eventually speared the king and speared the animals. And when the prophet came to inquire, did you do what God required? Oh, yes, I did what God required. And then the prophet asked, then if you did what God said, what is this bleating of sheep? And then he started to say, oh, my constituents said that they didn't want me to annihilate all the sheep, because the sheep are still good. And you know, he probably wanted to brag God and say, oh, I could offer some of these sheep as sacrifice. Some of them we could actually eat. But did God ask for sheep for sacrifice? Did God ask for sheep so that his people could eat money? No. God gave specific instructions, get rid of even the animals. And God said, I am going to take this kingdom away from you. And God eventually anointed another young man called David. And David was a man after God's own heart. He was a king that trusted in the word of God. But did you know that even the very good King David heard?
Yes.
You know, brothers and sisters, David erred by murdering a man and taking that man's wife. And then after David, God rose up another seed after David called Solomon. And Solomon was the most brilliant. He actually prayed a very humble prayer to God. He said, Lord, I'm just a young man, I'm just a youth, and I don't know how to go out and to go in. And young people, take some advice from Solomon rightly. You know, as you venture out on life's path, ask God to show you how to venture out. You know, even in choosing an occupation, you know that you should ask God. You know, brothers and sisters, sometimes, as I said, we fail our children. You know, sometimes we put certain things before our children and because of what society says is good or bad and put certain things up on pedestal. And even sometimes when we find that some of our children don't have the aptitude to be certain things, we look beyond them. You know, we measure people by our standards. So if they don't show the aptitude to be an engineer or a doctor or a lawyer, one of these jobs that we think are good jobs, We kind of relegate them to the background. You know, sometimes when we are even selecting officers for the church, or do you work at TVJO, where are we to make you the communications director? Do you work at this or that law firm, or I'm going to make you the director of wills and trust? How the church should operate is that you should choose leaders one through prayer.
Amen. Yes.
And brothers and sisters, I'm not talking about the way we are always doing. You know, it reached a point where I never wanted to be a part of nominating committees. Because sometimes you say, oh, we are going to pray for the leaders of our church, and people come with a list. Have mercy. Oh, I'm going to ask for God's direction. But you come with a list. Sounds like somebody's waiting on God's direction. And we just look at people from the outside, but the Bible says that God looks at their hearts. And some things that we put, the Bible says that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination to God.
Come on,
the Bible says anything that man highly esteems, and some of those texts we have forgotten are Seventh-day Adventists. Says anything that is highly esteemed among men is usually abomination to God. And sometimes we emphasize, oh God, there and get a lofty career, but we don't emphasize no Jesus. Don't emphasize farmer. You know, we would emphasize in our children, oh, go out there and ensure that you know your biology book. Ensure that you know geography like the back of your hand. Ensure that you know chemistry and mathematics. Make sure you can solve quadratic equations. And then when it comes onto God's word, you relegate it to the back page. You know, brothers and sisters, you don't only make something unimportant by saying it's unimportant. You know, our children know when we mean something.
Yes.
You know, you say, oh, I love Jesus and Jesus. And you're here on Sabbath, oh, Jesus, Jesus. Yes. And you're carrying on. Your children know who you are every day of the week.
Yes.
And they know whether or not you put any importance on the word of God.
Yes.
They know.
Yes.
They know. If the entire week you have never picked up the Bible, you don't even study the quarter.
Yes.
And our quarter these days are easier to study than they were 50 years ago. Because you couldn't study a quarterly 50 years ago on Friday night. Sometimes even Sabbath morning we are sweating through the quarterly. And then we come here and, oh Jesus, you're the grandest thing. You're all the world to me. My life, my joy, my all. But your children know that that is not true. Your children know that you have never had morning worship for the entire week. Your children know that. And God is saying that to lead, you have to become a minister, a servant.
Amen.
So you want to lead us, well, ensure that you are serving your children the right way. Amen.
Amen.
But we want to lord things over them. Oh, you must hear me. And do this and do that. And then we will quote things and we would say, the Bible said children obey your parents, and we'll just stop it right there. But the Bible actually said children obey your parents in the Lord.
Amen.
For this is right. Sometimes we might ask things of our children that are not in the Lord. I remember people used to say that to me. My mother had a shop and she was selling cigarettes. And when I decided to become a Seventh-day Adventist, I decided that I won't be selling these cigarettes anymore. And I remember she and other persons would quote this text to me, children, see what? You're going against even the God that you slave to serve. Because the Bible says, obey your parents. I have to show her that God said in the Lord.
Yeah.
And I thank God that even though she threatened to put me out of the house, that I stick to what God required.
Yeah.
Because eventually she stopped selling the cigarettes.
Yeah.
And she quarreled with me for over 1 year. For over 1 year, Christ. I would just turn and you need to attend to your own thing. And I would just take a step because, brothers and sisters, I personally believe that I should be respectful at all times to my parents. But when it comes on to principles, matters of principles of heaven, brothers and sisters, my parent is God. My parent is God. Because God does not guarantee that your children or your parents will make it to eternity. But you are responsible 100% for your own soul. Because the Bible actually predicted in Matthew 24 that as it comes to the last days, that there will be variance in homes. And many people have to choose between God and their earthly family. You know, even Jesus, Desire of Ages amplifies something that is in the Bible when Mary and his brethren came to talk to Jesus. In Desire of Ages, Sister White said that the priest went and spoke to Mary and Joseph and said that, well, Mary, Joseph was dead at the time. And spoke to Mary and said, you know, your son is going out of the regular land. And you need to go and talk to your son. And Jesus was impressed by the Spirit of God that is what his mother was coming about. And then when she came, and they said that your mother and your brothers are outside. Jesus said, who is my mother and who are my brethren? My mother and my brethren are those who will do the will of my Father, which is in heaven. So Jesus had to say, yes, I know biologically, I am connected to that lady. I know that these people are my kinfolk, but when it comes on to God's way, my family takes the back burner. And I remember I lived to see my mother stand in that shop one day and someone came for cigarettes and she looked at the person and said, you will never get cigarettes again in this shop. Amen. Because I will not be found guilty for killing people.
Amen. Amen.
You know, sometimes God's will carry you into some tricky situation.
Yes.
It's not all the time that God will lead into green pastures. The 23rd Psalm says, yes, God will lead into green pastures, but he also leads in the valley of the shadow of death. But whether he leads in the valley of the shadow of death or green pastures, God remains God and we should listen to God.
Yes.
And not man.
Yes.
Because brothers and sisters, a test is coming, which will test where our loyalty lies. And we have to exercise and practice every day loyalty to God.
Amen.
That is what this life is about right now. It is a practice for loyalty to God. We have every decision we make daily. It is a rehearsal as to how we will respond in the long run.
Yes.
When you get a sponge and you squeeze it, the only thing that comes out is what went into it.
Yes.
And a big squeeze is coming one day, brothers and sisters.
Okay.
So we have to learn now to absorb the character of Christ.
Yes.
So that when we are squeezed, the only thing that comes out is the character of Christ.
Amen.
And brothers and sisters, if your children are not too young to learn what the character of Christ is, never too young. If your children can solve a quadratic equation, they can understand the doctrines of this church. Because we have some of the brightest children. I personally taught Cornerstone for years in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I come to realize how brilliant our children are.
Yes.
Brilliant. And these minds are the minds that God wants to transform this earth and turn it the right side up. God wants a generation of youth that are prepared. I heard my sister pray. And she prayed and outlined that the judgment has set and the books have been opened. And how can we stand in that great day? You know, I outlined that Jesus has called us to lead as servants. And you know that we are not only called to serve our church, we are called to serve society as well.
Amen.
There's one statement from the pen of inspiration that says, as Joseph was in Egypt and Daniel was in Babylon, so Seventh-day Adventists are called to be in this world.
Amen.
You know that is the privilege of being a Seventh-day Adventist.
Amen.
You know that the Bible, you remember when Jesus was walking down the road to Emmaus? And then the disciples were confused and worried and distraught about how he died, and he promised he would resurrect on the third day, and they were confused. And he said to them, both fools and slow of heart. And he said that, didn't Christ predict that these things would happen, that he would rise again on the third day? And the Bible says, and he took them from Moses and all the prophets, and told them the things concerning himself. You know that everything in all the books of the Bible, Genesis, is about Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And you know that all the little accounts that we read in the Bible really speak to bigger realities. Because even Joseph speaks to a bigger reality. Do you realize that Joseph had 11 other brothers? He had different brothers. But most of the brothers came from different mothers. And doesn't the Bible say in Jeremiah 6 verse 2 that he has likened the daughter of Zion unto a delicate and comely woman? So a woman in prophecy represents a church. And Joseph's brethren came from different women or different mothers. And Joseph was almost born at the end, right? Joseph was the second to last child. And Joseph had this gift of prophecy. He could see the future. And he saw a prophecy in the future that his brother's harvest will come and bow down to his harvest. That they would have a harvest, you know. They would have a harvest, but their harvest will come to him eventually. Now, does that sound familiar? Does it sound like a church in the end time that will be born close to the end? And that eventually all the harvest of the other churches will actually come to this harvest? Jesus said, other sheep I have which are what? Not of this fold. Then will I what? Bring also into what? This fold. So God is actually using Joseph to speak about us. So in that account, we are actually like Joseph in the world. And God says that he called Seventh-day Adventists to be like Joseph in the world. Do you know that Joseph received prophetic insights from God that there would be a famine in the land? And he showed Joseph how to preserve things for that famine. Now, does the Bible predict that there one day will be a famine in the land? Not for bread and water, but for what? The word of God. Who is God entrusting to ensure that when that famine comes, there is food in God's house? Joseph loved his brothers. And you know, even though they are different mothers, they all have the same father. You know, we belong to different churches, but do you know that we have the same father? And God wasn't saying Joseph was better than his brothers. It's that he trusted Joseph to stand in a certain position. We are not better than the other churches, brothers and sisters. And we are talking about leadership and character still. Because really the purpose of giving our youth proper leadership and character development is so that they can stand as Joseph in these last days.
Amen.
That is the beautiful, honorable position that God has called you all to. Every last one of you young people are Joseph. Every last one of you young people. You have a highly exalted and extraordinary purpose in God. And you might be called to be lawyers, doctors, teachers, farmers, and I included farmers. Because we have spurned farming. And we think that you're backward if you're farming. But brothers and sisters, I can do without going to the hospital. I haven't been there from the day I was born. I never went back to the hospital. I can do without a lawyer, but I can never do without food. So brothers and sisters, there are many avenues of occupation that can be, and all work is honorable. Hold on, silent.
Yes.
You know that you can become a multi-millionaire from collecting garbage?
Yes.
It is the system that you use to collect garbage.
Yes.
There is this company in the United States, 1-800-GOT-JOB. And the man was flipping burgers at McDonald's. And he had a little rundown pickup. And one day he was passing this garage and he saw the garage full with junk. And he said, If you should pay me $500, I will take away all the junk in that garage. And the man said, oh, $500, I'd gladly give it up. And then he saw there a business model. You know, some people just say junk, but that man saw a business model. And he said, well, there must be other people in this vicinity that want to get their junk out. So I just go around, charge $500, and so on. But when they have larger volumes of junk, then the money goes up by increments. And right now, the man has a multi-million dollar company. Basically, he's a garbage man. But he's a garbage man making millions of dollars. So brothers and sisters, it's how we view things. So if your daughter comes to you and says that, oh, mommy, I'm not so hot with this solving quadratic equation, but I saw real well. Don't look at her and say, no, what kind of worthless thing that, and move from in front of my face. You're a disgrace to me. No. You know that she can sew dresses and earn millions of dollars. You know one of the wealthiest billionaires that comes on this show called Shark Tank. He's a venture capitalist these days. His name is Damon John. And Damon John was a tailor. He used to sew these shirts and so on, and then eventually he saw this trend. There was this company called Cross Colors that became popular, and they wore these colorful clothes. I used to wear Cross Colors. Back in the 90s, it was one of the more popular brands. And then he saw this trend of wearing brightly colored clothes and big baggy pants and big shirts and so on. And he started to design this logo at F&B, and he called this company FUBU, For Us By Us. And he started the brand FUBU, and today this tailor is a multi-billionaire. I didn't say millionaire. Now your daughter or your son can choose to sew, but it is the man that they use, and worse, and even better yet, we have God on our side.
Yeah.
And if God can allow Damon John to become a multi-billionaire tailor, God can take our children much further. So it is the man that we use, brothers and sisters. You know, we have to learn to see from God's perspective. We have to think with new thoughts and see with new eyes. And the reason I'm saying this is because I heard my sister pray, and she asked that God could prepare us in this judgment. For how shall we stand in the judgment? And we are talking about leadership and character development, right?
Yes.
I'm going to go in a very strange direction. I'm not going to come here and tell you, don't do this and don't do that, don't eat this and don't eat that. I'm going to share with you a much larger vision. Because you know the Bible says that the devil finds work for idle hands.
Yes.
And the reason why we are going backwards, brothers and sisters, in this day of atonement, is because we are not understanding the work God has for us.
Amen.
And I want to share something here from first manuscript release, page 228 and 229. And I want us all to be hearing this. It says, God's purpose in giving the third angel's message to the world is to prepare a people to stand true to him during the investigative judgment. Very important, right? God wants a people to stand true to him during the investigative judgment. It says here, this is the purpose for which we establish and maintain our publishing houses, our schools, our sanitariums, hygienic restaurants, treatment rooms, and food factories. This is our purpose in carrying forward every line of work in the cause. The sanitariums that shall be established are to be God's memorials, agencies in the conversion of many souls. Our sanitariums have been established for the purpose of preparing a people for the second coming of our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Now we all say amen. Amen.
Amen.
God says God's purpose in giving us the third angel's message is to prepare us to stand in the investigative judgment, and we are in that judgment right now.
Yes.
And she says that because of this preparation, we will need sanitariums, hygienic restaurants, health food factories, schools, publishing houses. Now, brothers and sisters, do we have a sanitarium in Jamaica? No. Well, not one that functions up to God's standard. We have a nice hospital in a location that we have done some research on that.
Yes.
But we have a hospital, but a hospital is not really a sanitarium. And there are persons struggling. Even the president of Central Jamaica Conference, Pastor Levi Johnson, wants to create a sanitarium right here on that big property, Cap Verde. Yeah, Verde, yes. He wants to create a sanitarium there. And I endorse that vision. Because God said to prepare our people to stand in the judgment, we need sanitariums.
Amen.
Do we have health food factories?
No.
No. I know probably if one of our young people said that they want to explore nutrition as a career path or cooking, we probably look down on that.
Yeah.
But God says to prepare our people to stand in the judgment, we need health food factories.
Amen.
You know that there was a gentleman who was dying of cancer. And the doctors said that they couldn't do anything for him and he should just go home and die. And he went into a used bookstore and found a book called Counsels on Diets and Foods. This man is not a Seventh-day Adventist, as far as I know. Now this gentleman read Counsels on Diets and Foods and obeyed the counsels in that book. You know the Bible says that God will bless faith. He didn't say God will bless Adventist faith. God said God will bless faith. So if anybody comes to God through faith, needing his help, God is going to assist. Sometimes we believe that we have monopolized God as a being. You know, but we have not.
Mm-hmm.
Now this man went with his normal faith. And he exercised faith in our health message, and he was restored.
Yeah.
You know, this man did something that many Seventh-day Adventists fight against.
Yes.
But he obeyed the health message, and he was restored from cancer. And the man said, you know what? I can't keep this wonderful secret. I can't keep this to myself.
Amen.
I am going to create a factory that will make health food so that other people can eat health.
Yeah.
This man is not a Seventh-day Adventist. And he invented something called the garden burger. And the man became a multi-millionaire. You know that the Bible says in 2 Chronicles 20 verse 20 that you must believe in the Lord God so you will be established. Believe his prophets so shall you what? Prosper. Now this man believed God's prophet and he wasn't a Seventh-day Adventist. And there was a council in the book, Councils and Diets and Food, that says we should start health food factories. And this man obeyed God and became a multi-millionaire.
Amen.
Now, do you think that God's grand plan was to make that man a millionaire?
No. It was really far one of us to do it.
You know, we have Kellogg's conflicts because somebody believed the prophet. John Harvey Kellogg and his brother believed the prophet. And then rose up one conflicts factory. Then eventually it became two. And one of them turned away from God's prophet and his conflicts factory went down. And his brother, who still obeyed God's counsels, kept his conflicts factory, and then over time became a multi-millionaire, and eventually he died and his posterity stole the conflicts factory. But brothers and sisters, today we can munch and tell us conflicts, and it is because of inspiration. So we are being quite foolish when we ignore God's prophet. You know, when it says here that we need publishing houses, we need hygienic restaurants. You know, right now I challenge somebody's denomination, and you are not believing. Amen.
Amen.
We like to glorify the fact that we know the Sabbath is the right day. Oh, the Sabbath. Many people, unfortunately, will burn in hell knowing that the Sabbath is the right day and going to church on the Sabbath. Amen. You don't like that? Because the Bible has 10 commandments, not just the 4. It has 10 commandments, and the last 6 is summed up in you should love your neighbor as yourself. And oftentimes we know that the Sabbath is the right day, and we should get here before 9:15, but we do not love our neighbor as ourselves. So I ask God, I pray to God, I agonize with God, because to be 100% honest with you, I felt ashamed. I felt ashamed. And when I started to put it before God, I got a call from the Jamaica Business Development Corporation about a trip to Africa. The UNDP was putting it on, and I said, I would love to go. And when I went and found out more about it, they said that they would actually fund projects that want to train people. And then a couple months before that, a lady who I don't know from Argentina, she lives in Florida, I saw her on the internet, and I was talking about her about my plan to help people and train them. And that lady donated a brand new furnace with molds. Brand new furnace, so I could actually do the training. And this lady has not seen me to this very day. Just gave me a brand new furnace and other equipment to do the training. So when you have a heart to do something and you ask God, God will provide it. And I went to Africa, got additional training, and got off the way, so they are funding my training project.
Amen.
Now, I never had the resources to do it. All I had was the will, but God has the way.
Amen.
God says, I am the way, actually. Yes. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So, young people, if there is a vision in your mind and you want to do something great for God, and to my young people, we have made a mistake in asking God for a lightning miracle. Like we can't pay a light bill. I will ask God, God pay the light bill, and God pays the light bill. But we limit what God can do.
Yes.
God wants to pay more than your light bill.
Yes.
God wants to do some fantastic things that through you, and don't limit what he can do.
Yes.
If you want to raise up one of these factories, you can do it.
Yes.
If you want to raise up a restaurant, you can do it.
Yes.
If you want to raise up a sanitarium, you can do it. Because God is more than able.
Yes.
God spoke this world into existence, and he can speak money into your pocket.
Yes.
He can speak the resources. He can speak the equipment.
Yes.
And God wants to raise up a generation. Isaiah 58 talks about people fasting, denying themselves food. And God had to come and teach his nation what the true fast is. Isaiah 58 in closing and beginning at verse where it says, "Be ye whole, you fast, but strive and be, and to smite with the fist of wickedness. You shall not fast as you do this day, to make your voice to be heard on high. Is it such a fast that I have chosen, and therefore a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Wilt thou call this a fast and an acceptable day unto the Lord? Is it not this, is that this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, and to do heavy burdens, and to let your oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? Is it not to thee thy bread to whom? The hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house. When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and thou hide not thyself from thy own flesh. Then God says, then shall what happen? Thy light shall what? Break forth as the morning, and thy health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy
real
reward. So God said, this is my true fast. And if you close the chapter, you realize that he starts to talk about the Sabbath. And he says, when you remove your foot from the Sabbath and call it a delight, I will call you to cause you to ride upon the high places of the earth. But all of those promises are in the context of what he placed before. Because doing all these things, this moral fast, is actually preparing you for holiness. Because this is selfless work. And selflessness is holiness. God is holy because God is selfless. And God is calling us to selflessness so we can have holiness. And the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. A selfish person, one who just lives for themselves, cannot keep the Sabbath holy. Because all sin stems from selfishness. You know, people tell you that the opposite of love is here, the opposite of love is selfishness. And that is the greatest malady that is affecting both young and old, selfishness. Because we live unto ourselves. The reason why we sin is that we live unto ourselves. And God is calling us today to a higher calling. If you want to be leaders in the truest faith, prepare to be ministers. And to truly minister, you have to be selfless. Now I want to invite to the altar persons who have seen in their own heart that they have been selfish. That you want to overcome selfishness and become selfless. And I invite my young people first. If you are here and you realize that you have a vision for God, but you have not been doing it, and God is faithful to tug on your heart, and you want to be selfless, brothers and sisters, we even can't accomplish selflessness by ourselves.
No.
Only a selfless God can put selflessness in you. But to my young people first, I invite you to the altar if you want a closer walk with God. If you want to serve him in spirit and truth. And older persons, I don't want people urging young people to the altar, let them come by their own volition.
Yes.
Because sometimes we run behind them and we nudge them, and we have not allowed them to intelligently assess if they are prepared to do what God requires of them. You know what God says, before a man builds a tower, he should first go to cause. And God is calling us to self-sacrifice. It's not an easy thing in our flesh to do. But God is able to see us through. And brothers and sisters, the young people come here without no false excitement. I don't have to come, we don't have to create false excitement. You know that young people really love God in your heart.
Yeah.
And oftentimes we believe we have to put on Muppet shows and all those things to bring young people. Young people love God, naturally.
Yeah.
And this generation is the keep it real generation. This generation doesn't want people playing games with them. The young people respond to God easier than us older people.
Yeah.
They come naturally to God. Now to the older persons. You see in your own heart that you have failed the young people in being an accurate example. And nothing is wrong in admitting when we are fallen. That is how we really repent. We know that we have not been standard bearers as we ought to be. We have not yet sacrificed as we ought to sacrifice. And God is calling older persons to a recommitment. To say, God, I have failed, but you are success. And if you walk with me, I can overcome and lead our young people aright. Because brothers and sisters, the church needs older persons to help to mentor the youth. And if you want to be one of those mentors, I invite you to the altar. Because God wants mentors. And brothers and sisters, we should be assessing it as we go. You know, because one writer says that at every altar call, angels come and they take report. And if we're coming and we don't mean it, God is going to take a report of that. God wants us to come because we honestly need it. Right at the altar, Lord, there are many talents. Every one of us who were born of the Spirit that received the Holy Ghost at baptism, we got a spiritual gift as well. Every last one of us have a spiritual gift. And Lord, everyone at this altar has one. I'm asking God that you would help them to realize what that gift is. Help them to tap into it and help them to use it aright. Help them also to use the various talents that you have given them. Some are musically inclined. This morning the choir sang so beautifully. And I thank God for the gift of music. And I know that others have the talent of drawing, others have the talent of cooking, others have the talent of just being a good listener. Others have the talent of just helping willingly. And I ask God, whatever spiritual gift or talent that you have invested in them, that they will use it. To upbuild this church. I pray God that they will not only upbuild the church but the community as well. There are many unemployed youth in the community. And Lord, help us as Adventists have a vision for this community. Lord, we don't have to leave this hill time after time going into the big city to find work. Because employment can be created up here. Show your people how to create infrastructure in Lawrence Tavern. To create employment in Lawrence Tavern. Lawrence Tavern can have furniture factory, upholstery shops. It can have restaurants, it can have various industries. Give your people a vision to upbuild themselves and the community. Lord, give your people a vision for farming opportunities in this wonderful area. Give them a vision for eco-tourist ventures that can happen in this very community. Give them a vision for apparel industries that can start in this very community so that they can complete this building and complete this community. Lord, I ask that you give us a vision lest we perish. Give us as leaders a vision lest we perish. Give us as youth a vision lest we perish. Give us a vision as your children. Give us a vision lest we perish. Lord, help us to have the leadership that you prescribe in the Bible, the leadership that requires servitude, and help us to have the character required to do this work and to finish it. Thank you for this church, Lord. Thank you for these young people with such a vision to have such a youth day. In Christ's name, I pray that you would bless and prosper them according to your riches and your will in glory. Amen.